Well, it's definitely true that you know, we have to learn how to be patient. We have to learn how to be allow ourselves to evolve in our time, because our time and spirit's time are two very different things. Because as you probably know, spirit doesn't have any time. The reason they don't have any time is because they're not physical, and time is a function of distance. Therefore, it's man-made.
I've been able to partner with Mind Valley to present you guys free master classes between 60 and 90 minutes covering mind, body, soul, relationships, and conscious entrepreneurship, taught by spiritual masters, yogis, spiritual thought leaders, and best-selling authors. Just head over to nextlevelsoul.com/free. I'd like to welcome to the show, Chris Lippincott. How you doing, Chris?
Hey, Alex. How are you doing? Great to be here.
I'm good, my friend. I'm good. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm excited to talk to you because I haven't spoken to many mediums on the show before, and I'm fascinated with the process and the messages and all of that. Kind of, I know a lot of people are always a little confused about what mediums are and what's the difference between that and a clairvoyant and a psychic and all these other kind of terms that we know. But before we get into it, how did you start this journey? What was the journey that got you to the place where you started to be awakened?
Yeah, that's a good question. If you want to think about it from the very beginning, I was aware of spirit as a child, but at the time, of course, I didn't really know what it was. You know, because when I was a child, probably 6, maybe 7 years old, you know, I was in contact with other people that were outside and they were having full-on conversations with me, but nobody else could see them. And I didn't know what was going on. I thought, oh, it's just my active imagination, right? This is great. And then at nighttime, there are some times where I would actually hear voices in my room, which as a kid scared me to death. I thought there was like the monsters coming from under my bed to take me away, right? Mm-hmm. All the Hollywood ghost stories. And at one point, I even had a hand touch my back while I was on my bed, on my stomach, trying to sleep. And yeah, that was for me kind of like almost like the culmination of what was going on as a child. That is kind of, I started to beg them to go away. And sure enough, I got my wish. They went away. And then I suppressed it probably for, you know, a whole bunch of decades. I just said, no, you know, I don't want to deal with this. And I went into finance, became this very logical, materialistic, you know, guy who was just not even thinking about anything spiritual, religious, or spirit of any kind. And I was noticing that I was getting really, really stressed out at work because I was on Wall Street. I was going absolutely crazy with my job. And I heard somewhere, oh yeah, you want to try meditation. Meditation is really a relaxing thing. I was like, meditation, you know, cause I looked at people who did meditation as, you know, a little bit out there, you know, somebody from the Hindu Kush. I'm like, that's not for me. Right. So I just said, well, you know, let's go find a video or rather an audio track that, you resonates with me and maybe it'll work. So I did. And I became so hooked on that one particular track that I wound up doing it every day for, you know, 15, 20 minutes or so. So that way I'd be really relaxed in the morning and I'd go to work really, really chilled out. But I did this every day for about 12 months. And then at the end of that 12 month period, I'm in my man cave because every guy's got to have his man cave. And what winds up happening is I am somehow, after about 30 minutes, I'm mentally taken away to some space that's very much of a, you know, out of this realm area. And I just remember being, I don't want to say visited by, but seeing these four people in silhouette. There were, you know, spirit people that were coming to me, and I felt I recognized them, but I didn't really know who they were. And the one all the way to my right, who is the tallest and felt the most powerful, I noticed was suddenly sending like this energy beam straight through my chest, out through my back, which, you know, shocked the bejesus out of me. Because I'm like, wait a second, you mean I'm not sleeping? You mean this is real? Because I could feel it. And then it just kept on escalating from there, going to the point where all of a sudden I began to feel I was completely loved. I was completely at one with the universe. And I began to realize the singularity that we're all here and the illusion of the duality in the physical. And it really shocked me. And soon after that awakening, all my family in spirit started coming to me in rapid succession in these dream visitations. And then I started to feel people around me. I could feel the energy. I could feel the tingling all around me. I could sense energy. I knew there were people around me just like I was when I was a child. So I knew something had happened. I knew the portal had quote unquote reopened, right? And that's kind of when I had to start looking into this. I had to investigate what was going on. How do I control it? How do I work with it? And what can I do with it? Because at some point I realized, this is not just for me. This is for the greater good of the world, which sort of took on a whole new platform, as it were.
So was this during meditations or during the dreams that you're having all these visions?
Oh, the vision, there were dream visitations. And, there are dream visitation based on the fact that a dream visitation is so crisp and detailed to the nth degree, and you can remember all of the details specifically for years. For example, I remember my father visited me. This was years ago. I can remember everything we said. He wasn't opening his mouth. It was more, I guess, mental telepathy or just using the mind. I remember his smell. I remember the colors. I remember exactly where we were. So all these dream visitations are very specific, and they're easily discernible from just a regular dream. The regular dream, you can't really remember what happened. It's kind of vague. You're not quite sure what it's about, and you easily forget it. Dream visitations, you'll remember the details for years on end.
Yeah, it's really interesting because, I mean, we all have dreams, and I've been told by many different spiritual masters and clairvoyants and mediums that dreams, there's no accidental dream. Every dream is a message. Every dream is something that they're trying to tell you. Sometimes they're clumsy in the messaging because they can't just straight out and say, hey, this is what's happening. They'll show you some sort of analogy or representation of what they're trying to say. Rarely do I get, when I have my dreams, I rarely get voices. They come in sometimes, like the people talking, and I remember the voices. That happens every once in a while. But most of the times, it's just big, giant analogies of things that, analogy is not the word I'm using, kind of like some sort of story trying to tell me something deeper about what's coming, whether it's something I have to do, something that's going to come in the future to prepare myself. Sometimes it's just a visitation of an old grandparent, mm-hmm. who just wants to just, hey man, just letting you know I'm here and wanted to show you some love tonight. Those kind of things. What's your take on it?
Yeah, well, what's interesting is we've discovered over the years that everybody travels the astral realm at night, every night. Mm-hmm. We're connected to the ethereal cord. It's a silver cord, and that's how our astral body travels to the astral plane. And that's where we kind of meet up with our family and spirit, regardless of what plane they're on. That's kind of like the meeting point. And so every night we're actually meeting with different people. And most of the time, we're not going to remember it. And right. That's why a lot of people just don't even remember their dreams at all. They say, oh, I don't dream. Like, yeah, you do. You just don't realize you do. A lot of it's obviously subconscious. A lot of it's obviously your mind grappling with all the garbage that your subconscious is dealing with during the day. But there's also a lot of times when you are in fact connecting with spirit in the astral realm on a regular basis.
So the definition of a medium, can you explain what a medium is? And the question that many people is, do you see dead people?
Well, what I say is sometimes talking to dead people is a lot more fun than talking to people who are walking around on the street, I find.
I could imagine.
Oh yeah, it's a lot more fun. They got a sense of humor too. Because what's great about spirit is their personality does not change. I can give you an example. There was one time I was sitting for a reading, giving somebody a contact, and the first person who walked in for the reading was this man who just had this uproarious laughter, and then he's got this pint of beer in his hand. He goes, "Hey, you want a drink?" I just burst into laughter. I couldn't help it. And this kind of stuff happens all the time. It's their personality they want to bring through. And that's how you connect with spirit, is right off the bat. If you know their personality, you feel their personality, you describe that personality, immediately people go, "Oh yeah, that's right. That's Harry," or whatever. Right. So that's the kind of thing.
Do you ever, like, just sitting around during the day and then someone walks by you and you're like, "I'm sorry, excuse me. Do you know a John? Cause he's here and he's got a message for you."
Oh, you never do that. You never do that. No.
Does that come in though? I mean, you might not say it, but do those messages come in going, "Do you see that lady in the corner over there?" Does that ever happen?
No, because what mediums do is we turn on and turn off our portal. It's kind of like we have a sign, right? We flick on the sign.
Open for business.
Right? Open, literally. We think to ourselves, "Open for business. Come on in." We invite spirit in. And then we just kind of like step into this daydream-like state. You know, it's like the best way I can describe it would be, I think when you're back in grade school and it's like, you know, you got like 2 weeks left of school, you're zoning out, staring out the window. Exactly. Your mind is outside. You're not in that classroom. That's daydreaming. That's the same thing when you're sort of in a light altered state and you're connecting with spirit. You're out here somewhere, right? And that's really what it's about.
So that's, but you don't actually, because I've heard some mediums seeing people and other people hearing, just, you know, coming through, that there's no visuals of it, but there's visuals in their mind. But then there's other mediums that have visual representations of, like, literally seeing dead people, like in The Sixth Sense. Is that,
yeah,
which,
right,
which is the talent that you have or the skill that you have?
Well, I mean, I definitely see spirits. I'll see the images they give me. It's
in your mind.
Okay. In my mind, it's clairvoyance. I'll definitely get all the feelings, like their personality, their character traits, their hobbies, and all the things they like to do. What were they most like? And so I get their feelings, and, you know, upbeat, downbeat, funny, gregarious, outgoing, whatever it is. So I get those feelings. That's really one of the more tangible aspects of it. And then I'll also have clairaudience, where I'll start to hear either music, which seems to be a favorite of theirs, at least for me, because, you know, I love music. So I've got music. And then what spirit basically does is, you know, they'll go into our memory bank and they'll start pulling files, as it were, of, you know, what's relevant. And they'll say, "Oh," and they'll kind of go through the Rolodex and they'll go, "Oh, all right. Like, oh, I see something. I see a song that works. Let's plug and play." And all of a sudden I'm hearing like a fragment of a song. I don't know why I'm hearing it, but I just know I'm hearing it. And all of a sudden, it has a very specific relevance to the sitter. And it's absolutely bizarre. Or I can think of a couple of examples. Like once I was doing reading for a woman, and all of a sudden I'm hearing Guns N' Roses. I'm like, "I don't know Guns N' Roses. Why am I saying Guns N' Roses? But I'm hearing Guns N' Roses. You want to sing Guns N' Roses?" And the woman just goes, Oh my God. "For the last 2 weeks, I've been hearing nothing but Guns N' Roses, Guns N' Roses." Apparently that was their, you know, the couple's favorite group, I guess. And you know, that kind of stuff happens all the time because it's so easy to recognize a song.
And it seems like it's customized to either you, that you understand it, but more specifically for the person you're reading. So in a similar, explaining it to the audience listening, kind of like when you have a dream and there's something that means, so if you're thinking of, let's say, politics for whatever reason, and there's a politician, you know, they're going to use that politician. Or if it's a singer, it's a singer that, you know, they're not going to bust out a singer from the 20s that you have no idea who they are, a movie star from the 30s or 40s.
Exactly. What they're going to do is use your reference material that's in your memory bank, and they can go way back because, like I said, you know, our minds are basically an open book, and they'll go through our minds and our memory bank and use what we know. So that way we can describe it. Very similar to, let's say, symbology, you know, in clairvoyance, they'll use symbology for different meanings. And so they'll start showing you things that are important to you. And you're like, oh, yeah, okay, I remember that. And it has a certain meaning. Now, what they bring through doesn't always have to have a meaning that you understand. All it requires is that you understand what they're saying or the information they're giving you. And then you give the information to the sitter. They're the ones that will understand it. Mediums are nothing but a relay station.
Conduit.
We're kind of like, we're literally a conduit, a channel, a relay station, a satellite dish, a telephone booth, whatever you want to call it. That's what we are. We're just here in the middle. We're the middleman. They're trying to dial up the sitter, and we're here. We receive the information and give the signal. That's all we do.
Right, exactly. So if you're having a sitting and you're going, I keep seeing a cowboy hat. Does that mean anything to you? And they'll be like, oh my God, my grandpa wore a cowboy hat every day of his life. Or something along those, something real specific to the person you're reading.
Right. Because put the shoe on the other foot. If you were suddenly in spirit, how would you describe yourself to somebody else?
Right. Because it's not like you're talking to me directly. So like, let's say my grandfather was sitting here. He knows how to talk to me and he knows things about me, but you don't. So he would be like, tell him about that time in the shop where this happened. And you're like, oh my God, the peach. Yeah. Oh my God, the peach, that whole thing that happened with the peach, something along those lines.
Shared memories are a big one because if you can bring through, if spirit is able to bring through, well, they're always able to do whatever they want. But if we're communicating with spirit well enough, we encourage them to give us shared memories. It's the combination of the personality and the shared memories that'll land them pretty quickly.
Now, does it stress you out physically? Does it stress you physically when you go through some of these?
No, because what happens is that when spirit's bringing through their energy, I'm receiving, their energy. When you've got a good contact, it's like being in trance. When you're in trance, you feel the flow of spirit. You're energized, literally energized by spirit's energy, because that's what spirit is. So when you're in contact and channeling spirit, you're fully energized. If you find that you're getting a headache or you're tired or you're exhausted after doing a couple of readings, you haven't really been connecting well enough with spirit, because you've really been trying to do it mostly by your own mind, your own head, as opposed to spiritually connecting.
In other words, you're trying to muscle your way through it, if you will, and you'll get tired. Yeah,
you'll get tired if you're not connected well enough. If you've got a good connection, then you're just going to be receiving all that love and energy and that healing. Because that's the great thing about being a medium, is that for all the healing that the sitter gets as a channel, I get a residual portion of that healing. It's just a beautiful feeling.
Right. Now, I have to ask you, I mean, you were talking about you being a Wall Street guy, and you kind of denounced all of this for a couple decades, as you said, and then you just rediscovered it. It kind of just came knocking on your door. It's kind of almost like spirit just said, let him have his fun, let him do his thing. He's going to figure it out. And then this is not his path, but we're going to let him go down this road for a little bit. And then we're going to knock on the door and go, okay, it's time. Here we go. How did your social group around you, whether it be colleagues, family, how did you deal with that? Because I can imagine that not everybody was like, oh, thank you, you're a medium now. Oh, Oh, thank God. I've been waiting for this, Chris. So, so how did you deal with it on a psycho, just on a human level? How did you deal with it?
Yeah, that's a great question. In the beginning, as what happens with most mediums is in the beginning, I was in the closet about my mediumship, right? I was like, no, this just can't be me. I'm just not gonna let anybody know, right? Because I was thinking, oh man, I must be a total oddball here. This is going crazy. And you know, clearly spirit had been leading me by the nose, you know, all this time, trying to make me aware of it. And eventually, as I started to accept it over a course of years, I'm like, all right, you know, I can start to slowly crawl out of the closet. And eventually, you know, it's like, yeah, hey, guess what? I am a medium. And some of my friends said, hey, wow, that's great. Phenomenal. Other friends, not so much.
Right. Right. And so, I'm a family and all of that. I mean, everybody around you, because I have to imagine there's certain people that be like, great. And other people are like,
yeah. Oh yeah. In the beginning, well, at first I thought I was going crazy.
I'd imagine.
I was like, oh my God, I'm hearing voices. And the only people that hear voices are like these incredible gurus or people that are going crazy. Well, I know I'm not a guru. Oh my God.
I'm going nuts.
Yeah, I'm going nuts. And so when I started to tell my wife about this, she was a little perplexed at first because, you know, she's, you know, not very religious or spiritual at all. And she's like, what? Huh? And I even was like hesitant to tell her, and I was sort of like dripping pieces of information to her over time. And, you know, over time she kind of got used to it. And now she's like, oh, okay, great.
And does she abuse the servicer sometimes? Chris, what? I need to talk to Grandma. I need to talk to Grandma. I want to ask her about what we're going through here right now.
Yeah, right. Well, the funny thing is that sitters can actually shut themselves off without realizing it, because they'll either be skeptical or they'll have a negative attitude about it, or they can block it just with their thoughts. Because when a sitter is trying to be open, or I should say trying to, you know, connect with spirit, they have to be wide open. They have to be at a point where they are allowing themselves to receive, be full of love, full of healing, and full of high vibration. That's the biggest thing. And I always tell people when I begin a session, it's, you know, think of it like a three-way energy cocktail between you, me, and spirit. Spirit's always high energy and high vibration anyway. It's us humans that are the lumps on the log, right? We got to raise our vibration. And it's kind of like the analogy also of like plugging a phone into a wall. If you plug your cell phone into the wall and you're charging up your battery, all of a sudden you can start getting calls from anywhere in the world. Well, we can do the same thing in the material world. We can plug ourselves into the spiritual vibration and get a call from anywhere in the universe.
Fair enough. Now, I heard you talk about the human subtle energy system. What is that?
Good question. That's really our aura. It's all about our aura and the seven different bodies, spiritual bodies that we have. Everybody's got them. Not a lot of people know about it or see it, but our makeup is composed that between the seven different energy bodies that we've got. The physical body is like the first and foremost, but it's basically the makeup of all the other energy bodies that we have. And you can see the composite, if you will, just in the aura. And the aura has all the different colors that are manifest predominantly in those spirit bodies. And when you've probably heard of chakras and seen chakras and those colors, those will resonate out in the aura. And sometimes they've taken photos of the aura that reaches out to about 7 or 8 feet. And so that's huge. And so you can really get a sense of what a person's energy is like. Are they vivid? Do they have vivid colors? Do they have, you know, bright colorful aspects in their aura, or are they kind of dull and dark and dingy colors that are kind of like browns and blacks and, you know, muted colors? And it's just a reflection of the vibration.
Interesting. So that's that. Sometimes you meet somebody and you just kind of go, "Ugh, I want to take a shower afterwards." Yeah, because
you feel it.
You feel that energy.
You do. Everybody, and this is what I am so adamant about. Everybody has psychic senses. Everybody has them. I mean, look no farther than your gut instinct. Everyone's like, "Oh yeah, I got a gut instinct." You know, sometimes I feel I should do X, Y, or Z. And most of the time we ignore it, right? Because our logical conscious mind's yapping away and we don't even feel it. But that gut instinct is the solar plexus, and that's the seat of your clairsentience. And that's one of the major clairs that we work with. And we've all, we'll sometimes walk up to somebody, meet them for the first time, shake their hand and go, "I'm not so sure I like this person." Mm. Or maybe, maybe you're at some house or some party or someplace, and you walk into a room and you suddenly feel this like really heavy, dense energy. You're like, "Oh, this energy doesn't feel good." That's usually when you've walked into a room where somebody has just had a massive argument, because that energy is, it's residual energy there. The converse is also true. You could be at a party and you can literally feel the vibe. You can literally feel the energy.
I was visiting New York and a few years ago before the pandemic, and I went to 9/11. I went down to where 9/11 happened. I went to the museum and everything. And I haven't forgotten it. As I was walking towards it, the second I stepped onto the side, off the street, onto the sidewalk, on where the World Trade Center was, it hit me like a ton of bricks. I was just like, "Oh!" I felt the heaviness of that place. And then I consciously, seriously, was just trying to like deal with the energy that I was coming through, because you walk down into the museum, and you're at the bottom of the World Trade Center, where the buildings went down, and you just, the energy that was there, you're just like, the sadness, the feel, people have reported that going to Auschwitz, and you just, and you feel these places where there's been tragedy. It's stained the area. The energy of the area has been
exactly
stained in that way.
Battlefields
as well. It doesn't go away, especially. It was really interesting. And then, oddly enough, when you go to other places where, you're in the middle of a volcano somewhere in Hawaii, or just Hawaii in general. You walk off the plane in Maui and you're like,
I'm not going home. I'm going to stay here.
This is super cool. You feel there's a vibe there that's really interesting. But people do feel, and whether you're aware of it or not, these are energies that people feel.
Yeah, totally. And that's the whole thing. And because everything is vibration. And one of the things that, being the materialist that I was, I had to understand what was going on. So I started learning a little bit about quantum physics, a little bit of knowledge is a dangerous thing, but nonetheless.
I dabbled in quantum physics and neuroscience.
Kind of. What I discovered was that, quantum scientists have learned that 99.9999% of everything in existence is just empty space. And that empty space is filled with energy. And the example they use is, if you took a carbon atom and you then went to the nucleus and you expanded that nucleus to the size of a golf ball, the electron would be something like 2 miles away. Everything else would be empty space filled with energy.
It's pretty remarkable. I just had a quantum physics physicist on the show. He hasn't come out yet as of this recording, but he will be coming. I just had the conversation a couple of days ago, and he's a quantum physicist who deals in spirit. So he's a very interesting guy. And that's, he was great. He's using quantum physics to explain spirit. And vice versa. And he's written this massive book about it, but it was really interesting to see how much science is starting to catch up to what people have been talking about for 2000 years in spiritual texts, the concepts, right. The ideas of energy. Well, there's vibration.
And there's also a difference between Newtonian physics and quantum physics.
Correct.
That's where we're changing.
Materialism versus what's a materialist? The materialist, or when everything is like matter based, everything's matter, as opposed to quantum physics, which is energy and space, and a whole other conversation. And they still, and from what I understood in that conversation, he goes, quantum physics was started around about 100 years ago, and Einstein was trying to figure it out. And he goes, it's gotten nowhere since then. Like, seriously, 100 years later, pretty much everyone's still like, there's something here, we just don't know what it is yet.
Yeah.
They're still trying to figure it out.
I mean, that's what's so crazy. It's like, now they're also talking about, the dark matter in the universe. What fills the universe? It's like dark matter. What is dark matter? They don't know, but it's all theory.
Right. Exactly. But they're always trying to figure things out here and there. We're trying to move forward. Now back to the world of spirit, sir. Can you tell me the difference between spirit guides and angels? Because I haven't spoken about angels on the show very much, because angels have a connotation of religious connotation to it. Spirit guides, not so much. I'm not sure, you can call it a million different things. What are the differences between the two?
Sure. The spirit guides are guides that have evolved so far that they no longer need to reincarnate. They're so highly evolved that now they are seeking to help others still in the physical, and they literally have to go through intense training in order to be a guide. And you've got, just within the guides, you've got multiple levels of guides themselves. Each guide is more advanced than the other, and it's just a state of evolution. I remember we were in trance once, and somebody somehow got in contact with their own guide, and the guide started saying, "Don't think of us as anybody special. We're just farther along the path." I was like, and I heard that, and I was like, "Oh, that makes a lot of sense. Okay, I get it."
So are these like ascended masters?
Not so much ascended masters. Those are much those are perhaps the peak, if you will. Those are even higher. Mm-hmm. But spirit guides are with us all of our lives. When I say lives, I mean as in, multiple lives we live. Mm-hmm. Our main guide is typically the one that is going to be with us for most of our incarnated lives. We'll have a band of inner guides, around 7 guides or so, and then we'll have anywhere from 7 to 10. Then we'll have another outer band that's probably another 10-ish, and then we'll have beyond that a whole series of subcontractor guides that we can, right?
I love that, subcontractor guides. Are there good benefits in the spirit realm?
I don't know. You got to sign up with the union.
I'm assuming there's not many unions up there other than the one.
The only one. Yeah, right. But the subcontractor guides are the ones that you can call on for specific things. These might have been guides who might have been experts in their specialty, whatever they're, maybe under the earth, they were a specialist in real estate. Maybe you're trying to figure out something in real estate. You've got a real estate guide and you call upon them. They'll be in your life until that thing, whatever it is you're looking for, it's fixed, and then they go away.
But how do they help the situation?
If they're not you,
if they can't have a direct conversation with them.
Yeah. Well, what they do is they put things like any guides, what they do is they will put things on your path. They'll put things in front of you so that you'll be aware, you'll see them, or you'll start to, in your mind, become aware of certain ideas that
push you to a book, push you to a course, push you to something else that gives you the idea that, maybe I should pick up a Tony Robbins book, and like, that Tony Robbins book is exactly what I needed at this moment in my life, because this is where I'm going. But they're the ones that throw the idea into your head. Cause I still remember there was one time, when I started my whole journey in podcasting, it was over 7 years ago, almost 8 years ago, but I launched 7 years ago. And the thing that got me started was this book that was sitting in my Amazon list. And all of a sudden I was just like really just trying to figure something out. I'm like, I'm in a really dark place in my life. You know, we had a business that wasn't doing great and I was lost. And I was like, I need to find something. And all of a sudden something came into my mind to say, go check a look at Amazon. And I looked at Amazon and first thing that pops up is The 4-Hour Work Week by Tim Ferriss.
Oh yeah. Right.
And that book, I was like, you know what? Let me just read that. And that was the book that started all the education about online businesses, how to build this. And it's brought me to where I am today. But it was all started with that book that launched me into the direction that I am. Changed the course of my life, really.
Right. Right. And you know, that'll happen. I mean, for me, the same kind of thing happened was that before I even had my awakening, probably a good 20-ish years ago, I for some reason I had this voracious appetite for reading books on metaphysics, spirit, mediums. I didn't know why. I was just fascinated by it. But here I am still Mr. Materialist going, I don't believe in any of this stuff, but I was still fascinated by it. So spirit was kind of like, you know, Hansel and Gretel, right? They're dropping breadcrumbs of book titles in front of me. And it just kept on, you know, getting more and more severe until I'm on my bus ride into work one day. And I just happened to look out, you know, I'm on the bus is on 495. We're coming around the curve. And I just happened to glance out and staring me in the face was this gigantic billboard that said lights between us, you know, signs for the modern world or something. It was this most amazing book. I was like, I gotta get that book. And you know, I didn't have very good memory, but I knew exactly what I was gonna do that night when I got home.
That's amazing. Now, okay, so do we understand what spirit guides are? So what are angels then?
Angels, from my best understanding of what angels are, is they are the representation of the divine source energy. And I too like to avoid using the word like God or anything because it does have the connotation of religious aspects and, you know, that turns some people off. So I always refer to it as source because that's like the Big Bang. We're all kind of from source, right? And so from what I understand, it's basically angels are the representation of source energy. And it's, you know, they're similar in concept to spirit guides, except they're so evolved. These are beings that have never incarnated. Spirit guides always have incarnated because they have to know what it's like to live on this human planet, this material planet, and go through the pains of humanity. I mean, the pains of humanity in all likelihood just sucks. It hurts.
Right. Right. And completely, completely understandable. Now, do our relatives come with us and are with us? Like, so, you know, our grandparents hanging out, our aunts and uncles, or maybe some dear friends, people we had deep connections with once they pass, are they there helping us? Are they there just watching? Are they, like, what's going on?
Yeah, our departed family and loved ones in spirit do try to help us. They're not, you know, our guides. A lot of people confuse, you know, our family with spirit guides. They're typically not the same because they're not as evolved. They haven't been trained. They're not that far along the path. But what our family is, they are helpers. They are there for us. They are trying to help us as, you know, time progresses. So you'll always feel, you know, their love and sometimes, you know, you might be in a reading and, you know, they'll just come through. They're not always going to be there. They're not always going to come through, but, it's sort of a question of what's the greatest need. What's the highest need? Because spirit always, meets the highest need, not necessarily the wants. So what I always say, it's very much like the Rolling Stones. Can't always get what you want, but you get what you need.
Exactly. Now, what is intuition? Is that spirit guides or the universe, you know, or source trying to guide you through the path?
Intuition is, again, it's one of your clairs. It's your gut instinct. It's your clairsentience. You're feeling it. So when you're in contact with either spirit or your guides, you're going to feel it in your gut because it's that gut instinct. It's your intuition. As you connect with spirit, you've got to basically be listening to it because you'll have either a feeling that you ought to be doing something, or like a little tiny word comes into your mind or something. And it's so subtle that it's difficult to even hear because your mind's chattering away. If you just allow the thought to stay there and quiet that monkey mind of your, everyone's got this monkey mind. Everyone's just like chatting away, like, you know, bouncing off the walls. But if we allow that, clairsentience to open up and just listen to what spirit's trying to tell us, we'll hear it. And then the key is we got to act on it, because how many times have like you walked outside and said, God, I feel like I ought to bring my umbrella. Nah, forget it. You come back, you're soaking wet. It's an example like that.
So we've been talking about spirits and spirit guides and so on. What is the spirit realm like in from your experience?
What's really interesting is that spirit always tries to show themselves where they are now. In readings, what they'll do is they'll paint pictures of what they're like, of where they are, of the scenery where they are. So they can kind of, I don't want to say alleviate, but calm and soothe the sitter's mind. So the sitter goes, okay, yes, my dad or spouse or whatever, they're in a great place, because the spirit will start showing us examples of where they are. I can remember one time when a spirit, I think it was somebody's father, was coming through in a reading, and he started showing himself this beautiful house, this Italianate villa, just beautiful on the inside. There's this incredible porch on the outside, with, you know, the pillars on the top that are made of, I don't know, stone or something, that were like kind of curling all the way up. And there's also like these olive trees just in the background. And then you looked out, you saw the beautiful field. And what was amazing was that everything I was describing was the Italianate villa that he had lived in when he was still alive. So apparently what he's trying to get across is what he had transitioned to was a place that was similar to, but only even more beautiful. Because as I described it, that's what the two daughters were saying. They're saying that sounds very much like his villa, except for the fact that it's got that many more colors. The spirit world is got unlimited amounts of color. It's so vibrant. It's so colorful. And it's got, the colors are a representation of the vibration, because remember, color is nothing but a vibration. And likewise, the colors are giving off sound, music. Because again, everything is a vibration. So we're just dealing with vibrations in both colors and sounds. And it's very peaceful. You've got seven different planes where, as each person is evolving over time, they're moving up to a more rarefied, if you will, existence, a more evolved existence. Takes time, but as you allow yourself to learn, as you allow yourself to grow, you move up and you're kind of moving along your spiritual path in the spirit world.
Do you fear death anymore?
No.
Not at all.
Right? Sometimes these days, sometimes I welcome it.
With the way the world's going sometimes.
Exactly. I'm like, oh, I want to check it out.
let me know when I can get off this train, man. I want to head out. Yeah,
exactly.
Wait, but before the awakening, you had the same fear of death as many of us do.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, I was like, oh God, don't let this happen today. You know? Yeah. Sure. Yeah. I was like, because
everybody wants to go to heaven, but just not now.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, we're never really quite sure what's on the other side. We're like, what, you know, where am I going to land? Oh God, I hope I'm going to land in the right place.
Right. But I guess after you've been, obviously your experience and everything, you're like, okay, so you're here to go through your mission and help as many people as you can and evolve your own soul.
And yeah, this is, exactly.
This is probably not the first life you've done this in.
People have said that actually. So my mentors who have done spiritual assessments on me have actually said that it's every lifetime it's gotten progressively greater
or stronger.
I don't know, stronger. Yeah. Because it's like apparently in one of my lifetimes recently, I was like a monk, very focused on spirituality, which I thought monks were more religious, but apparently this one was very spiritual. And there was another one that was very much like a teacher, a spiritual teacher. And I know one of my guides is a rather profound spiritual teacher. And one of my guides is a Native American healer. So it's very interesting that they would start to come through this way. It's like apparently I've got some kind of relation there.
But the spirit guides are beings that won't reincarnate. They've now they're done. They're done with this level of the game.
Yes.
They're on another level of the game. They're the next
together.
Level. All together. Yeah. Completely. They're not coming back.
No. They've done their soul duty.
Literally. Now, you were mentioning the monkey mind. Is there a way or any advice you can give us to be able to quiet our minds to a place where we can listen and hear these either messages or at least feel the guidance that comes through this? The things that we all kind of understand with the intuition and the gut instinct, and you're like, I don't go into that business deal because you feel like this is not a good deal. You can't trust that person, that kind of stuff. But a lot of times we ignore it because of the monkey brain. What can we do to quiet down? I meditate. I'm a heavy meditator. And that's really helped ground me and open me up to a lot of things. What's your advice?
Yeah, absolutely. Meditation is perhaps the first and foremost thing that anybody and everybody should be doing if they want to A, calm themselves down, but also B, begin to receive and or connect with spirit. Because you can't really hear or understand what's going on if your mind is, you know, going 20 miles a minute. I mean, 20 miles a second. It's just like, it's just going way too fast. So meditation is critical. Find a guided meditation that really resonates with you. And you've got to meditate every day. It's less the duration as much as the consistency. So if you can meditate 10, maybe 15 minutes a day, every day, then all of a sudden you'll find yourself after maybe 6-9 months, you'll really start to see yourself beginning to shift, beginning to open up, beginning to realize more that's around you. And so the meditation is absolutely critical.
It's really interesting. Even a few times as we've been talking today, time seems to be a prerequisite for spirit, meaning that anything that really is valued or is valuable in our evolution takes time, takes not months. You just said 9 months later, you'll start to feel like that's a substantial amount of time for someone to do something without any results. Whereas in spirit, so many times people, especially in the West, can I get enlightened tomorrow? How can I hack? How can I biohack enlightenment? Like, you know,
I want a life hack, please.
A life hack or soul hack for enlightenment, trademarked. No, but like it, from your experience, you know, going through all of this, you don't talk about spirit and evolution of your soul or of your spirit, even in a lifetime. You talk about it in years and decades before substantial things start to open up and start to happen. And, you know, when you meditate, like I've been meditating 6 years, it took me a long time. It took me probably a year before I started to get real, real benefit from it. And then now it's kind of a snowball. Like now it grows and it's, you know, I could tap into it really easily and things like that. But it's like any major skill that you need to do, it takes time. But with spirit, I've noticed even in the spiritual text, it's just like, oh yeah, that's not this decade, next decade. You're just like, oh my God. So what's your what's your feeling on that?
Well, it's definitely true that we have to learn how to be patient. We have to learn how to be allow ourselves to evolve in our time, because our time and spirit's time are two very different things. Because as you probably know, spirit doesn't have any time. The reason they don't have any time is because they're not physical, and time is a function of distance. Therefore, it's man-made.
Time is based about our rotation around the sun. If we were in Jupiter, our time would be different. If we were in a different galaxy, our quote unquote time would be different. So time is a construct that we've created to just kind of move things along for ourselves, but it doesn't really exist. I mean, if you just scientifically, it doesn't really exist.
No, not at all. And that's the thing. We feel it exists because we've grown up that way. We deal with the sun, and it's, always going around for that, 23 hours and 54 minutes or something like that. Mm-hmm. And we're working with that. Yet the point is that's a physical construct. Spirit's not physical. Therefore there is no construct related to time. To them, they measure things based on milestones, what has happened to them. So that's really like mile markers.
Right. Exactly. So many of us come down here looking for a mission, looking for a purpose in life. And so many of us are caught up in, being in the stock market. I mean, like, who wants to do that? So like working in the stock market for two decades, obviously you were off your path. This wasn't your true path, but something pulled you back in. What is there any advice you can give us that we can kind of find our meaning, our purpose, our mission in this life, what we're here to learn a little bit quicker, or just something to help us guide us? Because so many of us are lost.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's kind of the biggest thing that I'm always trying to help people do, is to find out what is their mission. And the thing for me that I found out is that the way you can really discover, or at least unfold what your purpose is to find out what gives you the greatest joy. Because so many people are saying, okay, well, I got to support my family. I got to do this work. I got to go to Las Vegas and win the lottery, or whatever it is. And the concept is, what is it that gives you the greatest joy? And it's got to be joy from deep, deep, deep down within. Most of the time you'll find that helping other people in some fashion will give you the greatest joy. And it's not something where you're getting recognized for it specifically, but the fact that you're actually helping another human being just typically makes you feel that much better. I mean, imagine the last time you were, helping somebody out. Maybe you held the door for a senior citizen, or you got somebody's paper, or you smiled at somebody who didn't look so happy, and all of a sudden they returned on your smile and you made their day. I mean, these little things, it doesn't have to be like this monstrous type, action. It can even be the little things. So if you're starting to do that on a regular basis, and then you start to kind of increase it, like maybe you're working at a homeless shelter, maybe you're working at a soup kitchen, maybe you're, anonymously donating whatever, some percentage of your, wealth. It's like, what can you do to help other people? And that's ultimately what's going to help you find it, because it's your inner joy. And that's really our mission, is joy. That's why we came down here, is to have joy, but also undergo the tough lessons of the Earth School.
Of the Earth School, no question about it. Now, speaking of the Earth School, the Earth is having a little bit of a problem right now. There's a lot of stuff going on between pandemics and economies and politics and, different kinds of, war and aggression that's going on around the world. There seems to be a shift going on. There seems to be something. Yes. There seems to be something in the air, if you will. That's just not COVID. else. Something else seems to be in the air. There seems to be a shift going on. I'd love to hear your point of view of what is going on. What have you heard from Spirit and source about why we're going through this and where we're heading for this. Cause I don't think we're not at the bottom yet. No, I think we still got a little, we got a little bit of go before we hit the bottom, but what's your thing? What's your feeling?
Well, it's a great question because I was in a trance circle with somebody and he was connecting with his guide. And what came out was this beautiful commentary about everything that was happening. And it basically said in sum that the reason mankind is going through all this is to help us to work together, to help us to try to no longer be separate, but to come together as one, to try to love one another again, work with one another again, and try to bring back peace and harmony to the world. And kept saying, you know, we will not give you more than you can handle, but this is one way we know that you will be forced to come together in a unity to fix all the problems that you're experiencing.
So it seems that that's what's happening. Cause I mean, you know, when the pandemic hit, it affected the entire planet at the same time, which is something I've never seen before. No. I've never even heard of something completely affecting the entire world at the exact same moment. And there was a couple months in the pandemic that we all were at home. The entire world was at home, not moving. Boats weren't shipping. Flights weren't going anywhere. Like it was done. And you're just like, this seems insane.
Yeah, exactly.
This seems insane. There's a lot of talk about connecting to our higher selves. What does that mean to you as far as the higher self? Meaning our source, our soul is when you're connecting to higher self? And if that's the case, how do you have a closer connection to your soul? What really matters and not this meat suit that we walk around in.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Well, I mean, if you think about it, the soul actually has kind of almost two parts. There's the inner soul that is basically the vehicle to our spirit. And there's the higher soul, the higher self that is remaining in the spirit world. So that when we transition back, we ultimately are reconnecting with our higher self, our higher soul that remains there. And we actually are able to sometimes, if we connect with it here from the physical, we're actually able to get a different perspective. You may sometimes suddenly get this bizarre feeling or a bizarre view and different from a totally different perspective. You're like, whoa, where did I just get that idea? And it's, you know, it's your idea, but it's something where all of a sudden the view and the perspective of the view has completely shifted. You're now looking down at yourself and your awareness is from a different plane altogether, as opposed to, you know, I'm just here on this level and that's all I know. That's all I see. So it's a very different perspective, I guess you'd put it.
Now, I wanted to ask you about your book, The Spirit Beside Us. How did this come to be? And, you know, was this kind of like a channeled book or does it come through you? How did it come to be?
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned that because it really went from a blank page to published in about 3 or 4 months.
That's insane.
It was insane. It totally. It started out as just sort of like, you know, gee, I'd like to get my thoughts down on paper. I'd like to get the world to know what's going on. And then it just started flowing like, you know, the dam had burst open and I just went wild working at it. And I remember showing my manuscript to some of my mentors and they kind of looked at me and they said, you do realize that about half of that book's automatically written. And I'm like, oh, that explains why it was so fast.
it's just coming through you with your as they say, a spiritual stank on it. But it was coming through you as a conduit. If you
will. Yeah, exactly. I mean, they were moving my fingers faster than I knew what was going on. And the next thing I know, it's just, you know, plug and play. I'm like, all right, let her rip.
It's done. It's time to get out there. I'm going to ask you a couple questions that I ask all my guests. What is your mission in this life?
My mission in this life is to raise a spiritual healing, the spiritual awareness of consciousness and of humanity, is to really let the world know that we are not just this one life. Let the world know that the spirit lives on and that it's pure love and that it's nothing to be frightened of. It's not like a Hollywood ghost story, because that's what comes through, is pure love and healing. And if people know that their loved ones live on in a higher state, and they know that they're bringing through transformative love and healing, then your reality completely changes. It's very much like Plato's allegory of the cave, where he had, you know, the three prisoners, chained to the wall. They didn't know anything about, what was on the outside of the cave, because they'd never left the cave. One prisoner breaks free, sees the real world, sees people, trees, animals, sunshine, vegetation, absolutely surprised at the beautiful world. He comes running back, tells his co-prisoners, hey, you'll never believe what I saw out there. And none of them believe him, because it's beyond their understanding. They have no way of knowing.
Right, exactly. Very similar to if we would have been telling people 100 years ago about an iPhone, they'd be like, what's a phone?
Exactly. Yeah, totally.
So, and what is the ultimate purpose of life?
The ultimate purpose of life on Earth is to learn all the lessons that our spirit comes down to learn. It's a tough life, but otherwise, if we didn't experience these lessons, then we wouldn't learn them. It's very much like the five-year-old who you can tell 10 times, don't touch that hot stove, or else you burn yourself. Does the five-year-old ever listen? No. But one day he, touches that hot stove, and he will never touch that hot stove again, because he experienced pain. It's like us. We have to experience these frustrations, the pains of life, to learn the lessons. That's why so many times life seems so painful.
And where can people find out more about you, pick up your book, and find out all the services and things that you do?
Sure. You can look at my website, which is www.montclairmedium.com. You can find a book on Amazon. Just look at it, Spirits Beside Us. That's really, if you go to those two primary portals, those are really everything else. You'll see exactly the same information, both on Facebook, on Twitter, and Instagram. It's all Montclair Medium.
Chris, man, it's been a pleasure talking to you, my friend. Thank you so much for sharing your journey with us and answering some spiritual questions I know a lot of our listeners have. And I appreciate all the hard work that you've been doing over the course of your life so far, and trying to help as many people as you can. So I appreciate you, my friend. Thank you again.
Well, thank you so much, Alex. Great being here.